Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Illuminations by T. Kingfisher. Narrated by Raquel, Beattie. 1. Morning. Garlic Day. Messidor. The month of harvest. Once upon a time, there was a girl named Rosa. She had black hair and brown skin and brown eyes, and she was a little bit plump. And her favorite color was purple, and she was deeply, profoundly, exquisitely bored. "I am more bored than anyone has ever been in the history of the world," she said, lying on her back on her bed and staring at the distant ceiling. "However bored anyone has ever been, I am 100 times more bored than that." She was talking out loud to a painting. The painting didn't say anything, but then Rosa didn't expect it to. It was not a very good painting, but Rosa was not a very good painter. At least, not yet. She lived in the world-famous Studio Mandolini, home to the Mandolini family, the greatest painters of magical illuminations in the city. If you wanted a magical illumination, a painting that would carry a magical charm, you went to the Studio Mandolini and told them what you wanted, and they would paint it. Rosa was extremely proud of her family, even if they weren't doing anything to stop her from dying of boredom. The Mandolinis painted pictures of radishes with wings to ward off sickness, and they painted great droopy-faced hounds with halos to protect against burglars. They painted flaming swords on shingles to keep storms from blowing the roofs off houses. And they painted very strange pictures of men with hummingbird heads to keep venomous snakes out of people's gardens. And every one of these paintings worked, although they would wear out over time. Sometimes the illumination had to be very large. It was no good getting a tiny painting of a blue-eyed cat to keep mice away if you had a barn that was already full of rats. The tiny painting would keep mice out of your pantry, but to keep them out of a barn, you needed a painting 6 feet high with a blue-eyed cat the size of a tiger. It could be any sort of cat in any kind of position, but it had to have blue eyes. Illuminations were very specific that way. It didn't matter if your favorite color was purple. If you snuck into the pantry and painted the cat's eyes purple, it would stop working, and mice would come in and dance all over the cheese. Rosa had been very young when she gave the cat in the pantry purple eyes, and her grandmother had forgiven her for it, even though they had to throw out all the cheese. She was 5 years older now, 10, nearly 11, and a great deal wiser than when she was 5, nearly 6. She understood all about illuminations and how you never, ever changed them. And that was the problem. It was very boring when you wanted to draw, to always have to draw the same things the same way. Maybe you didn't want the man to have a hummingbird's head. Maybe you wanted him to have a crocodile's head, so he could open his mouth very wide and swallow up your chores. Maybe you wanted the cats to have purple eyes, or green eyes, or one green eye and one purple eye. Maybe you wanted to paint radishes with teeth instead of wings. The problem was that if you painted it that way, the magic wouldn't work. And the Studio Mandolini was famous for the fact that their illuminations always worked. Rosa loved her two uncles and her aunt and her cousin and her grandmother, who made up the Studio Mandolini. She loved them all very much, and they had taken very good care of her. Her parents had died so long ago that Rosa could barely remember them. But her family at the Studio Mandolini was wonderful. They did not always understand about Rosa's paintings, though.
"That's very interesting,"
said Uncle Marco, when she showed him her radish with teeth.
But isn't it supposed to have wings?
Needs wings, said her cousin Sergio, who talked in very short sentences, as if he was afraid he would run out of words. He was only 25, but he was already losing his hair.
Won't sell. No wings.
Interesting modern primitivist technique, said her Aunt Nadia, who was very thin and wore black and talked about art history a lot. I see what you're trying to do, subverting the very nature of illumination making. But I don't think the art world is ready, Rosa. You are too far ahead of your time. Rosa didn't want to be ahead of her time. She wanted to be an illumination painter. But the radishes didn't do anything. She could feel that there was something to them, something that was almost magic, but not quite. But that didn't matter. People wanted the real thing.
It's lovely, said Uncle Alfonso. It's art, that's what it is. Not stuffy illuminations. That's a different sort of magic.
And he took a pin and put Rosa's radish up on the wall of his studio, where he put all the things that interested him, like drawings of hands and woodpecker feathers, and an empty turtle shell, and oak leaves with big spotted puffballs on them. Uncle Alfonso was her very favorite relative. He was actually a great uncle, or an uncle once removed. Rosa wasn't quite sure how it worked. He was also even older than Grandmama, because people had very big families in those days, and Grandmama's brother had started having children before Grandmama's mother had quite finished. So Uncle Alfonso had been born 6 months before his own aunt. Uncle Alfonso always called her Rosalita, which meant little Rose, and no one was allowed to call her that but him. Even if they didn't always understand about her radishes, her family was very nice. Dinner time was always loud, and everyone laughed a great deal and told stories and jokes, and no one was allowed to talk about sad things because, as Grandmama said, it would upset the digestion. There was actually an illumination painted on the table of two peppermills crossed like swords to prevent indigestion and queasiness and upset stomach. But Grandmama Mandolini did not believe in taking chances. She loved her family, and she could not imagine living anywhere other than the Studio Mandolini. But her family was also very busy, because they were the very best in the world. And so when Rosa was bored, she had to find ways to entertain herself. 2. The Studio Mandolini was very tall and had windows all the way up to the ceiling to let in the light that was so essential for painting. The ground floor was cut up into little rooms called bays, but none of the bays had ceilings. Everyone had their own walls and their own personal workspace and a bedroom behind the workspace up against the wall. Rosa had slept for a long time on the couch in Grandmama's room, but when she turned 9, she was given her very own bay in the studio. It was a little bit bare because everyone else had big stacks of canvases and wooden boards to paint on, and Rosa had only a pad of paper and a pencil and lots of drawings of radishes. But it was her very own. Uncle Alfonso had given her an interesting owl feather, which she had tacked up on the wall next to her very best radish drawing. Aunt Nadia had painted an illumination to ward away nightmares of a cheerful little pig surrounded by flames. The flames did not seem to be bothering the pig at all. Rosa put it up over her bed, and whenever she did not have a nightmare, she thought very kindly of Aunt Nadia. It was not quite perfect. At night, she could hear Cousin Sergio snoring in his bay next to hers. And sometimes, when his allergies were bothering him, Uncle Alfonso would snore too, and Rosa would have to put a pillow over her head to drown them all out. Usually, though, it was pretty good. But not today. Today, rain was coming down gray and drizzly against the enormous studio windows, and Rosa was as bored as she had ever been in her life. She had drawn radishes until she was tired of them. Some had teeth, and some had claws, and some breathed fire, but none of them had wings. She had read all her books several times over. She had tried to write a story, but she couldn't think of what the story should be about. So she added in a monster to come and eat the hero. She wrote "The End" and signed her name. But while this was somewhat satisfying, it was also only 6 lines long, and she still had the rest of the afternoon left to go. "I'm bored," she told Cousin Sergio.
"Can't talk," he said. "Painting, nearly done."
"I'm bored," she told Uncle Marco.
"Hmm," said Uncle Marco. "Interesting."
"No," said Rosa. "It's not. If it were interesting, I wouldn't be bored. Being bored is the opposite of interesting."
Uncle Marco pushed his glasses up on his nose.
"You could go play outside."
"It's raining."
"Rain is very interesting."
Rosa gave up and went to the next bay. She gave Aunt Nadia's studio a very wide berth, because Aunt Nadia was doing a big painting for the Merchants Guild, which required 11 angels holding various objects, and which was supposed to ward off bribery and corruption, and also termites. Aunt Nadia liked to work from live models if she could, and if Rosa went into the studio, she would undoubtedly be dressed up in angel robes and told to hold very still. Rosa didn't mind modeling for paintings. She had done it lots of times. There was an illumination on the wall of the grocery to keep food from spoiling that was actually a painting of Rosa as a baby. Rosa always felt smug when she went into the grocery and saw it there. Sitting still for hours was surprisingly hard, though. You started to get stiff in muscles that you didn't even know existed. You got breaks every few minutes, but the rest of the time you had to sit absolutely still and not whine and not fidget. If you moved even a little, the artist had to either change the painting or rush over and move you back to the way you had been, and it was all a great deal more difficult than anyone who hadn't done it would think. So she snuck past Aunt Nadia's bay, feeling just a tiny bit guilty. Uncle Alfonso had gone out to buy paint, and that left only Grandmama Mandolini. Grandmama was bent over a ledger, making sure that the studio accounts balanced. It was not the sort of thing that a 10-year-old could help with, even if she was nearly 11.
"I'm bored," announced Rosa.
"Go play with Serena," said Grandmama, not taking her eyes off the ledger. Rosa scowled.
"I don't always like Serena," she said.
"Nonsense," said Grandmama. "You're best friends, or you were last week. Go play." Rosa heaved a great sigh, but there was no arguing with that tone of voice. She put on her shoes and picked up an umbrella and went to go play with Serena. Serena lived 3 blocks away, on the main street, instead of at the end of a higgledy-piggledy alleyway. Her family were illumination painters too, but not as talented or as famous as Studio Mandolini. Rosa had been telling the exact truth when she said that she didn't always like Serena.
She wasn't entirely sure that she liked her right now. But at least walking to Serena's house would give her something to do. Serena was a year and a bit older and had just turned 12. They had been thrown together for years because even very sensible grown-ups seem to believe that children will be friends simply because they are the same age. When they had been younger, they would play together, and Serena would always say, "You have to do what I say because I'm older." It was some years before Rosa realized that Serena would always be older, and there was never going to be a time when they did what Rosa wanted. This seemed very unfair. "Life isn't fair," Aunt Nadia said when Rosa told her this. "But she'll probably die first, being older, so it works out." This was not the sort of comfort that Rosa was looking for. Aunt Nadia was bad with children, and even worse with adults. When they were young, they had pretended to be horses, which was fine, or great beauties, which was less fine. You could usually insert a monster into a story about horses, but not one about great beauties. "We'll be great beauties," said Serena. "We'll take the town by storm and go to the opera and the theater, and everyone will be dying to be seen with us. And I'm the prettiest." "Then I'm the smartest," said Rosa. "Then I'm the most fashionable," said Serena. "And I'm the bravest," said Rosa. Serena scowled. "You don't need to be bravest," she said. "What if there are monsters?" "There aren't any monsters in this story." "There could be a little monster," said Rosa hopefully. "At the opera, maybe? It could come into our box at the opera, and you can swoon very prettily, and people will fan you and bring you lemon ices, and I will kick the monster in the head with my boots." "Great beauties don't wear boots to the opera," said Serena darkly. "I'm not the fashionable one," said Rosa. "So I've got boots." "You're such a child," said Serena, and refused to play anymore. It didn't help that Serena was very pretty, with deep amber skin and hair like black silk, and that she was already nearly 4 inches taller than Rosa. Lately, Serena had stopped saying, "You have to do what I say," and had started rolling her eyes and saying, "You'll understand when you're older." As if an extra year was a brick wall 30 feet high, and Rosa was on the wrong side of it. And she frequently didn't want to play any games at all, but instead wanted to talk about boys that she thought were handsome. Rosa was skeptical of this, because Uncle Marco said that beautiful people were boring to paint, and that normal people, who had bumps and wrinkles and folds, were much more interesting. Being interesting seemed like a much better deal than being handsome, but that only made Serena roll her eyes harder. But despite all this, sometimes they were still friends. And Serena and Rosa would lay on the floor of Serena's bedroom and draw pictures. Serena drew horses and unicorns and griffins, and Rosa drew horses and monsters and fanged radishes. Those were pretty good times. Serena's horses were better. Rosa had a hard time getting the hind legs right. But Rosa's monsters were bigger and had more teeth and fangs and eyeballs and whiskers. And they never argued about the future, the real future. Not the pretend one, where they were beauties and the toast of the town. The real future, they both knew, was that they would learn the family trade and become illuminators, and spend their lives painting in the studios where they had grown up. 3. Afternoon, garlic day, Messidor, the month of harvest. Rosa turned down the street where Serena lived. You could see her family's studio right away, because it had a portico, like an archway with columns. You couldn't possibly miss it. There were gold letters over the grand portico, proclaiming it the home of the Studio Magnifico. Rosa ignored it and went to the smaller entrance next door. Serena's family didn't sleep in their studios the way that Rosa's did. They had ordinary bedrooms and weren't surrounded by canvases all the time.
"Strange way for an artist to live," Uncle Marco had said when Rosa told him that. "How can you make art when you aren't breathing it in while you dream?"
"Hush," said Uncle Alfonso.
"All artists are different. As long as what they are doing works for them, it is no business of ours to say it's wrong."
Rosa said nothing, but she was secretly proud of the fact that the Mandolinis slept in their studios and dreamed with their art. It was one more thing that made the Studio Mandolini special, and just a little bit better than the Studio Magnifico. Not that Serena would ever admit it. The sidewalks here weren't full of cracks and loose cobblestones the way they were in Rosa's neighborhood. You could still smell the canal, though. No matter how rich a neighborhood was, you couldn't get away from the city's canals. In high summer, when the smell was worst, they usually went to Rosa's house because it was in an older neighborhood and had been placed farther away from the water. Most of the time, though, Serena insisted they draw at the Studio Magnifico because her bedroom was bigger than Rosa's bay and the floors were soft carpet instead of hard tile. Rosa knocked on the house door and waited. Serena's brother came to the door. He looked down at Rosa, he was very tall, and said,
"Oh, it's you."
"Is Serena home?" asked Rosa. Serena's brother was 17 and almost a grown-up. He had been working at the Studio Magnifico for 2 years now.
"Sure," he said, holding the door open.
He turned and yelled,
"Serena!" over his shoulder. "Serena! Someone's here for you!"
Serena appeared in the doorway a moment later. Her face fell when she saw Rosa, and Rosa couldn't help but feel like Serena had been expecting to see someone else. "Oh, it's you," she said, in a rather nastier tone than her brother had used. "I don't have time to play with you, Rosa. I have a commission." Rosa's eyebrows shot up. "A commission?" she said.
"You've got a commission?"
A commission was when a customer came to the studio and gave the painters money to make an illumination. Rosa saw it happen all the time at the studio, but had never imagined that someone would commission a 12-year-old.
"Of course," said Serena. "I'm an illumination painter, you know."
She lifted her chin.
"Yeah, but you're a kid," said Rosa. "Nobody commissions kids."
Serena flushed.
"I am 12, she said angrily. "And I do have a commission, because everybody knows that the Studio Magnifico are the best painters in the city, no matter how old we are."
Rosa blinked. Serena had never said anything like that before. And so Rosa didn't have time to think of a better reply than,
"But the Mandolinis, nobody wants Mandolini commissions anymore. You're too weird and old-fashioned."
Finally, Rosa managed to say,
"We are not."
But it sounded small and weak and much too late.
"You are. Our family is going to leave yours in the dust."
And she stomped away, leaving Rosa very startled on the doorstep. Her brother caught the door before it slammed shut.
"Don't listen to her," he told Rosa. "The cafe down the street wants illuminations on all their jar lids to keep the grain moths out. It's 27 drawings of griffins holding acorns, that's all."
She draws really good griffins, said Rosa glumly.
Yeah, said her brother. But to hear her talk, she's got a commission to paint charms on the dynast's lapdog's collar. Don't worry about it.
He waved to Rosa and shut the door. Rosa walked back home, dragging her feet.
We're not weird, she said angrily under her breath. And we are the best.
Admittedly, she was talking to herself, and maybe that was a little bit weird. But it was because she was angry, not because she was a Mandolini. Mandolinis weren't weird. Mandolinis were amazing and talented, and everybody knew they were the best illumination painters in the city. She couldn't believe that Serena had a commission, though, even if it was just drawing griffins on jar lids. Her shoulders sagged as she walked. She didn't have a commission. She didn't have any jobs to do. Nobody wanted her to draw fanged radishes for them. Fanged radishes didn't actually do anything. They weren't a proper illumination at all. She knew she shouldn't be jealous of Serena. You weren't supposed to be jealous of your friends. Although, after what Serena said, maybe we aren't friends after all. Boredom started to settle over her again, like a dull beige cloud. Now it was even worse, because it was mixed with a feeling that if she were better, or older, or just somehow more, she would have something to do. It was bad enough being bored. Being bored and inadequate was nearly unbearable. If I was older, I'd draw illuminations, real ones. I'd have real commissions and everything. She didn't let herself think about the alternative. Not every Mandolini became an illuminator. Grandmama didn't have the gift for magic, and even though she ran everything and the studio would fall apart without her, Rosa didn't want to be like that. She wanted to be an illuminator. But even when she drew everything exactly right, according to the books, it didn't become an illumination. Not quite. Sometimes there was a little bit of magic in it, but not enough. Not like Serena's griffins. Rosa let herself into the studio and closed the door, setting her back against it. She sighed from the bottom of her toes. Light streamed from the last bay. Her favorite uncle was home. 4. Evening, Garlic Day, Messidor, the month of harvest.
Serena said something strange, she told Uncle Alfonso, flinging herself into the overstuffed chair in his studio. The cushions made a very satisfying thwomp sound when she landed on them. Uncle Alfonso gazed at his painting, holding his brush in the air.
Ah, he said, sounding somewhat distracted.
Rosa poured out the story of what happened, except for the fact that she hadn't been able to think of anything to say, but we are not.
And Serena has a commission, she finished, trying not to sound as aggrieved as she really felt.
Good for her, said Uncle Alfonso. I'm sure she'll do well.
Rosa scowled. If Uncle Alfonso had a flaw, it was that he always saw the best in people and was happy for everyone.
But it's not true, is it? That we're old-fashioned and weird?
Uncle Alfonso considered this. He considered it for so long that Rosa started to get a tense knot in her stomach.
Uncle?
Well, he said. It's true that we're not as popular as we used to be. The Mandolinis have a particular style, you know, and tastes change. People want different things, and there aren't as many of us as there used to be, so we can't always keep up with commissions.
He placed a careful stroke on the painting.
We are not quite where we used to be.
Rosa felt the knot in her stomach drawing tighter.
But we still get commissions, don't we?
Oh, yes, said Uncle Alfonso. Enough to keep the studio going, and your Aunt Nadia has a commission for the Merchants Guild, and when it is done, they will pay us a great deal of money, and many influential people will see it, and perhaps they will want one like it.
He looked over from the painting and smiled at her.
It will be all right, Rosalita. Have faith.
Rosa wiggled her fingers. Her stomach felt a little better, but not completely.
Is there an illumination to make people like art?
An illumination to make people like art.
He made a delicate little brushstroke on the painting, adding a white highlight to a painted tomato.
Now that is a good question, Rosalita.
He pursed his lips.
Things that change people's moods are hard. You should check the codex.
Rosa slid out of the chair and went to go find the codex. There were two books in the studio of any illumination painter. One was the great Codex Iconographica, and one was the Iconographer's Concordance. Both of them were enormous and weighed 20 pounds each. Rosa grabbed the codex and staggered back to the chair. The book was as big as her torso, and she spread it open over her lap. The codex was an alphabetical listing, rather like a dictionary. Instead of definitions, it had descriptions of illuminations. If you looked up the word mice, for example. Mice. To ward off. Blue-eyed cat, any species. To attract. Round ball of cheese. To keep healthy. Mouse-headed man with the crescent moon under his feet. And by this, you would know what to paint in order to get the proper effect, whether you were trying to bring mice to you, or keep them away, or keep a pet mouse healthy. In truth, there was only so much you could do with the wards to keep animals or people healthy. If the mouse was already sick, an illumination couldn't fix it. And if the mouse wasn't being fed properly, or was old, or its cage was drafty, the mouse would get sick eventually, even if you put an illumination over its cage. Illuminations wore out quickly if you asked them to do impossible things. Even the radishes with wings that the Studio Mandolini sold only made sickness less likely. They could not banish it entirely. Rosa flipped through the codex to the L section. She found illuminations for warding off lions, and for keeping lice away, and to prevent lasagna from getting mushy. But nothing to make people like art. Then it occurred to her that she was looking things up wrong, and switched to A, but the section for art was 16 pages long, in very small print, and she gave up after two pages.
Well, said Uncle Alfonso, dabbing more paint on his brush. It's hard to change people's moods, as I said. Too close to changing minds, and that's forbidden.
I thought we could do an illumination to make people like our art, said Rosa.
Uncle Alfonso shook his head. Too dangerous. Where do you stop, Rosalita? What if someone wanted to change your mind so you wanted to do your chores, or to love squash?
Rosa stuck her tongue out. Yuck.
Yes, but you'd love it. You wouldn't have any choice. And in very little time, maybe we'd paint so many illuminations to change you that you wouldn't be you anymore. And then who would you be?
We'd only use the one, said Rosa. A small one.
Uncle Alfonso raised an eyebrow.
And then your friend Serena's family does a bigger one, so that people like their art better. And then the Studio La Serena across town paints one as big as a ceiling. Best not to start, I think.
Rosa shut the codex with a thump. Okay, she said. Maybe that isn't a good idea. Is there something else I can do to help?
To help?
You know, Rosa wiggled her fingers. To help the family. I can't make a painting for the Merchants Guild. I mean, unless they want radishes.
I am quite fond of your radishes, Rosalita.
Yeah, but you're my uncle. You have to like them. Uncle Alfonso smiled.
You put your heart into them. That's what matters. Every illumination takes a piece of the painter's heart, and that is why the magic works.
Rosa scowled. Doesn't that mean I'll run out of heart if I draw too many?
Fortunately, said Uncle Alfonso, you are still quite young. Your heart is growing so fast that you cannot possibly run out. In fact, it is probably wise if you draw as much as possible to keep it from exploding.
She stuck her tongue out at him. My heart isn't going to explode.
Probably not, said Uncle Alfonso. But there is no sense in taking chances.
He dabbed another stroke on the painting.
If you want to help, why don't you go into the basement?
What's in the basement?
Everything. Go poke around. But particularly look for the stuffed armadillo. And if you find it, bring it up. I need to paint an illumination to ward away blisters, and I've misplaced the armadillo.
Stuffed armadillos were quite interesting, and searching for one meant she was doing something useful, even if it wasn't as useful as taking a commission of her own. Rosa slid off the chair and went in search of the missing armadillo. 5. The basement of the Studio Mandolini had dozens of rooms. The rooms were full of closets, and all the rooms and all the closets were full of trunks and boxes and fascinating junk. Whenever one of the Mandolinis needed a model for a particular illumination, they would get it out of the basement. And whenever they finished painting that particular illumination, they would shove the model back in the basement. There were fabulous costumes for people to wear, and stuffed animals with glass eyes. Not like Rosa's favorite stuffed bear, but real animals that had once been alive and had been mounted on plaques after they died. There were props for the human models to hold, like swords and shields and spears, and props for them to wear, like crowns and tiaras and suits of armor. Mostly, however, there were boxes and boxes and boxes of junk. The artists were often very bad about labeling things, so there was no telling where anything actually was. You could find a dagger shoved carelessly into a bowl of wax fruit, and a stuffed wombat wedged into a trunk full of crowns. It was a glorious muddle. Rosa rolled up her sleeves and began hunting armadillos. She found boxes of candles and boxes of feathers, and boxes holding other boxes. She opened dusty trunks full of dusty clothes. She pulled down hat boxes that held fabulous hats, and hat boxes that held jumbles of shoes, and a hat box that was full of old paper wasp nests. She found stuffed ducks and stuffed weasels, and an enormous moth-eaten stuffed heron holding a fish in its beak, which Cousin Sergio had been looking for only last week. She did not find the armadillo. Someday someone must organize this, said Rosa grimly. It was something her grandmother said regularly,
and something Uncle Alfonso said as well. Sergio had yelled it while he was looking for the heron. Must organize! Too messy! Aunt Nadia had waved a languid hand and said, Why don't we just knock the building down? Then we can start over from scratch with proper labels this time. Grandmama had given Aunt Nadia a look for that, and Nadia had ducked her head and grinned. Well, if I never learn how to make illuminations, I could make it my life's work to clean the basement. That would be helpful for everybody, and I might finish before I die of old age. She looked over the sea of boxes. Or I might expire dramatically in a pile of stuffed badgers. She imagined herself, white-haired and older than Uncle Alfonso, having a dramatic death scene in the basement. Rosa clutched her chest, reeled, gasped out, Tell them I died for art, and flung herself backwards onto boxes. Then she giggled, which she probably wouldn't do if she was dead. Serena would have told her to hush, that corpses don't giggle. She had to give Serena credit. Serena loved a good death scene as much as Rosa did. She generally wanted to die of consumption or unrequited love, though, while Rosa preferred to be eaten by monsters. But once you were dying, you got to gasp out your last words and fall over, and that was always fun. Serena's last words were usually, Tell them I died for love. Rosa's last words were often, Ugh, it hurts! The pain! Why did the monster eat my legs? Then the other girl would hum the funeral march and throw fake rose petals until the dead one giggled too much to stay properly dead. This was all enormously satisfying. Rosa climbed out of the badger pile and looked around. There was a gap between boxes that led into the most crowded room of all. It was too small for a grown-up to get through, but Rosa wiggled sideways until she fit. Trunks and suitcases were piled up to the ceiling, and she had to climb a pile of boxes like a ladder to get into the back. There was a closet door back there with a label on the door that said, More stuff. This was not helpful at all. An armadillo probably counts as stuff, Rosa thought. At least it's stuffed, and things that are stuffed are definitely stuff. The hinges squealed when she pulled the door open. 6 bolts of lace fell out. They had been white once, but were yellow with age. A calendar fell down with them, and when she picked it up, the cover said, Coronation Edition. Rosa considered this. She had learned in school just last week that the dynast of the city had been crowned 32 years ago. The ceremony was called a coronation. That meant the calendar was 32 years old. It occurred to Rosa that no one had opened this closet since long before she was born. She shoved the bolts of lace aside, propping them up against the wall, and peered into the closet. On the shelf in front of her, just at eye level, there was a wooden box about 2 feet long and 8 inches high. It was propped up at an angle so that the lid faced her. The lid was dusty, but she could see painted figures through it. Rosa pulled down her sleeve and wiped it over the lid. The picture was of a crow. It had brilliantly painted eyes, and its beak was open in a silent caw. It was carrying something in its claws. She took all of this in about 3 seconds, because then she turned around and began pushing her way toward the door. At the ladder-like pile of boxes, she stopped. She had something else to do, didn't she? She had to climb sideways over the boxes, so she should be sure that she was finished in this room, because it would be a real pain to come back. And she wasn't finished, because she hadn't found the armadillo. Had she even looked for it? No, she'd been looking in the closet, and then she'd turned around and walked away in a hurry. Now, why did I do that? Wondered Rosa. She went back to the closet, looked at the box with the crow, and found herself back at the pile of boxes again. She had to go do something else, didn't she? No, I don't. I have absolutely nothing else to do, and that's why I'm here, because I'm bored. Stop telling me I have to go do something else. Rosa began to get a suspicion about what was going on, but Uncle Alfonso always said that the third time was the charm. She turned back to the closet, keeping her eyes fastened on the ceiling. When she was firmly in front of the closet shelves, she lowered her gaze slowly. Top shelf, hat boxes, nothing. Next shelf, coronation calendar and a couple of bags of yarn, nothing. Middle shelf, Rosa's feet turned her around, and her brain tried to tell her that she had something else to do somewhere else.
It's an illumination, said Rosa aloud.
You didn't grow up in a studio full of illumination painters without learning to recognize when a magic charm was actually working on you. She didn't recognize the crow, and she couldn't look at it long enough to make out what was in its claws, but it was undoubtedly an illumination.
Now that's interesting.
An illumination that could make people go away like that wasn't completely unheard of. Aunt Nadia made illuminations to keep burglars away sometimes, although they were expensive. They only kept casual burglars from deciding the house looked promising, though. They wouldn't stop someone who was already determined to rob you. To last this long, and to actually turn somebody around and send them off, instead of just making the box look boring or moldy or covered in spiders, that was a powerful illumination.
Why would somebody put an illumination like that on a box? Thought Rosa,
then immediately answered herself.
To protect something inside it. Something valuable. It could be gold, jewels, piles of money, or something expensive we could sell.
Rosa considered for a few minutes. Then she took out a pen. She always carried a pen in her pocket, because you could be struck by a really good idea for a painting anywhere, and you had to write it down at once.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.